You've reached the Signal Watch, movies, television, comics, and more. I'm your host, Ryan Steens. Join me and our cadre of co-contributors as we examine cultural artifacts of the 20th century, boldly explore the 21st, and try to put it all in perspective. Stay tuned. We're gonna try to make this work. Welcome back to the Signal Watch. We're going to give this a shot. And try and make it work, yeah, as I say.
Definitely.
With me today is...
Simon Day, hello.
And we decided we're going to, since we're both here, we've both seen it, we're going to talk a bit about...
1917, directed by Sam Mendes. So you saw this with, I think, Jamie and your dad?
Yeah, I saw it about a week ago.
Yeah, and I saw it actually with my British group about a week ago. I think we saw it the same weekend, actually. And we thought we'd talk about it because, you know, it's nice to talk about films that are actually still in theaters for change rather than decades old. But yeah, what were your thoughts? Because I'm interested in what you thought. What were your thoughts?
So, you know, I was talking to some people about the movie, and it's interesting to get people's different takes. I've definitely seen the Facebook friends who are like, you must see 1917, which I think is always a dangerous way to start talking about a movie.
Yeah.
Because I have a real problem with people overselling me on movies, and then I go in and I'm like, why were they, you know, in having vapors overseeing whatever this was?
Doesn't live up to it.
Never has, never will. Yeah. It's like, please, if you want me to see a movie,
apart from Kingdom of the Spiders,
it's like, but when you're coming at me with a movie, basically don't recommend it to me.
Yeah
just say I have seen it, and if I say how'd you like it, say it was good, and that's all I need to know. I don't need to be sold, because the second you try to start selling me on a movie, I'm gonna start looking for reasons why it's not as good as you thought it was, and I can't help it.
Just go, is it safe? I did hold this up. I was looking forward to, I can't talk, sorry. I was looking forward to this for several months before I saw it. And I was like, well, you know, I love Dunkirk. So I'm really looking forward to this. This looks great. This looks like kind of like Dunkirk but in World War One. So I guess I did hold it up a bit as something to look forward to. And I'll be honest, I was a bit disappointed.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I can expand on that.
Sure. Or... Yeah, please. We shouldn't just end it there.
Yeah, bye.
Ryan gave no opinion, and Simon was disappointed.
Door slammed. So I watched it, and I think it's a very solid film. I think it's obviously, you know, it's sold in this one shot where we're following the character, and we're almost with the character. And of course, you know, that isn't a proper one shot. There is clever editing in there, but it's very well done. I think it looks beautiful. I think, you know, performances are great. You know, some great actors in there doing some good stuff. Some lovely kind of scenes. And, you know, I'm very impressed how they created the trenches. Actually, you know, practically built those. But I kind of said to a friend the other day, he was like, and he hadn't seen it, and he was like, what do you think? And I said, well, my suspicions about Sam Mendes have kind of been confirmed, because I feel like Skyfall was a bit of a fluke, and I feel like all the rest of his films, going right back to American Beauty, I feel like incredibly well made, look beautiful, but there's no real heart, there's no passion. And they're chocolate box chocolate box films for kind of old ladies. You know, they're kind of like, they look great, but, you know, they don't get the blood kind of pumping. And I just kind of came out of it thinking, I've seen that done better. other places. Saving Private Ryan, Gallipoli, Mel Gibson. Mm-hmm. It's a very predictable plot. So like I say, you know, I was disappointed.
Yeah, I think for me, I don't would say I was disappointed because I went in with basically zero expectations.
And like I said, mine was probably too high.
And I was interested in it from a how do you do a movie about the trenches in 2020, and what does that even mean to an American audience? I think the U.S.
because the date on this was when the Americans joined the conflict, wasn't it? The date right. The start of it. Yes.
I think Americans basically don't know what to make of World War One, as we call it here. I don't know if you guys still call it the Great War in England or not, but
WW1. Yeah, we call it World War One as well. Okay. Yeah,
because you know we entered into it super late and reluctantly.
Yeah.
We tend to think of ourselves as having shown up and pulled everybody's fat out of the fire, which
same is, as World War II.
Yeah, of course. And I think there's probably a much bigger argument to be made for World War II, if at least we helped. But in World War I, the U.S. showed up so late in the game, and that generation had been long dead by the time I was ever born. It just wasn't really part. World War II is so huge in the American psyche. So also it was this thing we did that clearly didn't quite work out because we had World War II, or there wouldn't have been a sequel. But then, you know, I've done enough of my fair share of reading about World War I and was kind of aware of what trench life was like and all that. Yeah. So there weren't as many straight up surprises, but it was fascinating to see this basically an historical recreation of
what's interesting
how things were.
It's interesting for us as well because January seems to be turning into World War I month, because last year we saw they shall not grow old. So it's almost like I think also it's a harder war to portray because obviously we're further away from it.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems a lot more kind of, you know, hard to kind of like understand some of the concepts, you know, like planes and vehicles are still fairly new.
Right. It's the first real mechanized war.
Yeah.
And so you have the first basically assembly line murder of each other.
Yeah.
It had never really occurred like that we don't know how to not just line up and shoot at each other across a field. Oh, why don't we dig a hole and go live in that hole? And we'll still basically do the same thing.
Massive improvement.
Yeah, continually for years on end. It was absolute madness. And I think this movie manages to kind of show, and I think if anything, this movie is trying to say, like, you know, as always with war movies, let's not do this again.
Yeah.
Of course, which nobody ever pays attention to, and we're right back in it. But
you repeat the same mistakes.
Yeah. And so it's kind of like who's sacrificing what was the average day in someone's life like during this? Between the two movies, you just mentioned They Shall Not Grow Old.
Yeah.
I think
I felt a lot more emotional watching that. I did watching this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think from a technical perspective, I think people who I've seen kind of through 6 degrees of separation who like work in film and whatnot have really poo-pooed this movie in some ways that I think is kind of hilarious. It's like, look, dude, this is a technical achievement no matter like I'm glad yes we all understand they didn't really shoot it all in one day. Ryan Johnson, the director, had a joke on Twitter the other day.
His name is Sam Mendes.
What's that?
Sam Mendes, the director?
No, the director, Ryan Johnson. He was talking about it. They kept Benedict Cumberbatch just sitting in that room for like a month, and they kept having to start over and over. They ended up paying him like $35 million so he'd just stay in that room.
That's brilliant.
And then they'd have to start over again, and finally they got there.
We'll get to the end of the trench.
It's like, no, I mean, say what you will about like Rope and other movies that have tried to do the one-shot thing.
Goodfellas.
It can be a distraction, right? Like when I was talking to Jamie after the movie and my dad, they were like, my dad kind of didn't even notice it was one-shot. Jamie had known going in
that
it was, but she's like, I completely forgot. I spent the whole time going, how did they do this?
Yeah.
I was kind of going, is that tank real? Yeah. You know, is the plane really there? Like, what did they actually do to make this movie?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I suppose, you know, that's, like I say, you know, that I kind of admired it. And it's definitely worth seeing on a big screen. Don't get me wrong.
That was the only line I put when I wrote. I didn't do a write-up for this movie. I just did a, like, okay, I saw this movie. I just said, see this in the theater if you're going to bother to see
it. Yeah, biggest screen you can. Mm-hmm. In fact, you know, I think it's being pulled already. And it's a shame because I feel like this weekend they should have kept it in as many places as possible. But I guess they, you know, getting out of the way for Bad Boys 3. But yeah,
a real quality movie.
I mean, there you go. But it's like, I didn't really feel anything for the characters. And I did like the fact that, I mean, this is obviously going to have spoilers. I did like the fact that they killed off who you thought that was the lead character. And, you know, and his mate basically carried on. I thought that was good. But I'm just like, I've seen this done better other places. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, seeing someone get gutted, you know, by surprise in a war movie is almost a checkbox item.
Yeah, yeah. And PG kind of gutted. You know, this isn't Saving Private Ryan with heads flying off and stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's I guess if anything, I was somewhat secretly pleased that the guy who kept doing the dumb things was the one who ended up getting killed. Because in the movie, usually that's their reason that they have to come into their own, right? In most war movies, is like, oh no, I got my best friend killed.
Yeah. It's always the young guy who has to learn how to toughen up, isn't it?
Yeah. And this one was like, he's dead now. And this guy who got dragged into this against his will is now the one who has to make it to...
The realist kind of survives, whereas the enthusiastic one is like, we'll be home for Christmas. And it's like, well, haven't you already been there for how many years? It's like, you know, he gets killed. What do you think about the actors, having famous actors? Because I thought
it was a bit of a distraction.
I found, because I smiled to myself, because I was like, it's Mark Strong's legs. Followed by Mark Strong several minutes later.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, he can act with his legs.
I thought it was great casting for the part, if you're going to cast a named person.
Yeah, yeah.
Same thing with, you know, the other, you know, three or four people who were in there who you could kind of vaguely recognize.
Yeah, I think Andrew Scott was great as a guy who's like, there's another stupid idea, you're going over the top and all this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then there was a little bit of Colin Firth at the start. Yeah.
But, you know, at the same time, you're like, oh, you know, they're going to sign up some famous people.
Oh, yeah.
And so then you're thinking about that while you're watching the movie instead of just watching the movie.
A little bit distracting, yeah.
And so it becomes kind of this, like, technical thing where you're watching all of the pieces of how this thing works. And I don't necessarily like seeing the scenes of a movie while I'm watching it the first time. That's fine on a second or third viewing. But the first time I'm watching it, I don't want to be thinking. And that's all I thought about, honestly, for about half of the movie was... for example, when they had the town that was all bombed out at night and it was all the fire everywhere.
Oh, yeah, the silhouettes and stuff.
Yeah, I was just like, this is beautiful. Yeah. This is amazing cinematography, and they're able to do it all by doing kind of the George Miller keep whatever the focal point is dead center of the frame. But I'm thinking about that as I'm watching it.
Yeah.
But also was thinking about, what were they burning? What is this? Yeah. Like, did they actually build this set?
Well, I was also, you know, pulled out of it a little bit by the fact that, you know, he got a chance to kill some Germans to stop them causing him trouble in the future, and he didn't. And then, of course, he's chased and shot at. And, you know, and those vans that kind of transported him, I'm like, would they even have had those vans then? And also, how did they get across No Man's Land with those vans? And there's lots of, like, little bits that kind of troubled me, I guess, narratively.
Oh, they had trucks.
Yeah, but surely they would have had to come over the No Man's Land at some point from the British side, because they were in German territory then.
I mean, there weren't this... Yes. I mean, I don't know what direction or angle they were coming from.
Yeah.
I don't know any of that. Yeah. I got the feeling
and that... And the plane was a bit lucky, happening to aim for the only farmhouse in the area that they happened to be sheltering in. You know?
I mean, I don't know if that's a suicide run. If I'm going out, I'm taking these bastards with me, or I have no idea. It was interesting to see, just see a dog fight from that perspective. I don't remember seeing a dog fight.
It was so slow.
Yeah, like kind of off in the distance like that. Of that's how you would have seen it from the ground. Because you always, when you do see those movies, they always kind of do the flying circus aerial ballet thing.
Oh yeah,
And it's like, but like, when you're down on the ground, those planes are only flying 40 miles an hour, 60 miles an hour, so they look like they're
hardly moving.
Yeah, hanging up there.
Yeah. Now I'd be interested in watching it again, to be honest, just to see how I'd feel the second time. Now I've kind of lowered my expectations a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I remember watching, and I haven't seen Gallipoli, for instance, for years and years. I think it's Peter Weir, isn't it? Gallipoli, I think.
I don't remember.
But it's basically like Mel Gibson and the other fella, the blonde one. And I don't know if you remember, but in that, the story is they're both runners.
Oh, I've never seen it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, the story quickly is they're both runners. They both compete against each other. And, Mel Gibson's basically Mel Gibson, bit of a joke, the lad, and, kind of likes his cigarettes and beer and women and stuff. And the other guy's a bit more kind of puritanical. So it's a little bit Chariots of Fire. And then they become friends. And then they both sign up. And, they're kind of in the Aussie army, controlled by, the English, the evil Brits. And it ends with, spoilers for Gallipoli as well, by the way, it ends with, because they're both runners, they're both messengers.
Mm.
And so Mel Gibson's friend is about to be sent over the top of the trench. And, General or whatever gives Mel Gibson a message, you've got to stop them because they're going to get killed. And of course, the last part of the film is Mel Gibson running down the trench, pretty much the same as this,
mm-hmm.
but he gets there just too late. As they all go over the top, and the last shot is his friend just getting machine gun, kind of wild bunch style, just frozen in time. And I feel, I remember seeing that as a kid and that having a big emotional gut punch. Whereas this, I really care. I figured they were going to do the same thing with this. Maybe they were going to go over the top. And they kind of had their cake and ate it again, because it's like they'd already had a first wave. But then, of course, the little twist is, well, the brother survived. He was in the first wave, and now he's back here behind lines looking after people. And I'm like, boy, I don't really care. I didn't really...
I think I probably liked the ending better than you did. One, I'm... The ending where it was all for nothing in a war movie is so cliched at this point.
Yeah, that's a point. That's a good point.
That I was like, okay, well... But at the same time, it also, again, it has its cake and eats it too, because it's also like, by the way, we're going to go do this all again tomorrow.
Yeah.
So I think that is more almost like the point of what they were trying to get at with the movie, rather than feeling like they needed to have, he doesn't actually stop them on time, or he gets killed himself just before he hands over the message, or he gets arrested.
Well,
by
really depressing.
that's where I expect these movies to go, and because it's Oscar season, and how do you get people to say your movie is serious? You have the super bummer ending that's even more of a bummer than anyone could have possibly imagined, and
William Dafoe platoon type of.
Right.
Yeah, I think, yeah.
The guy lives to, manages to live another day. And of course, then you get that tag at the end of based on stories told by my, grandpappy or whatever.
Yeah.
I think is important to remember also when watching these things.
That actually perked me up, actually, more than the film. I felt like that kind of made me feel something like, oh, yeah, that this does come from somewhere. And that's where he probably got the story about the putting the oil on his head and the rats, eating it, and him having his ear bitten off. That's probably real stories.
Yeah, I don't really want to share them because I don't feel it's my place. But my grandfather fought in World War II in Africa and Italy.
Yeah,
and some of the stories he told me, if you put them together in a movie, it'd be dear God, sort of thing. And I just got a little smattering of stuff. Kind of as he was in his very final days.
I'm sure a lot of it as well would be almost too hard to believe. If you put it in a film, it would be like, no, this is crazy. This could never happen. It's like, yeah. We actually did.
Right, right. I mean, yeah. just you know, he managed to survive and a lot of his friends didn't, and he saw it. I'll just put it that way.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's kind of the important thing to remember when you're watching the movies, and I think that's why when you have that ending where it's like, by the way, based on stories as shared by my grandpappy,
yeah.
To me, at some point, it's like, the point isn't really what story they tried to tell. I think the story is moot.
Yeah.
I think it's more of the... I thought of this a little bit like the same way I thought of Gravity, when I saw Gravity in the theater. It's yeah. like, this is a theatrical experience.
Yeah.
It's an immersive thing, so you get the feeling of what it would be like to be one of these people for a mere 2 hours versus the years that the British had to serve on the front lines.
Yeah.
And get a little sliver of a taste of what the people in front of you went through. And I think that is pretty much the only thing to really get your teeth into on this movie. Because I agree, the story itself isn't really a story.
Yeah.
The characters are barely characters.
Yeah.
And there's a little bit of, like, usual movie plant and payoff stuff of, I said this at the beginning, and then at the end, this is how it pays off sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's really minimal. It's not trying to do a Lawrence of Arabia, or they're trying to build some epic tale. I think they're really just trying to share in the only way that a person in 2020 could understand something from 103 years ago.
Yeah.
What was going on? Because we're not going to drop people into, like, now we we experience war by playing, you know, tour, whatever that game is, Call of Duty.
It's very funny you should mention that, because that's a little bit of a criticism of mine. I think a little bit like being in a computer game. Playing a World War One computer game. And I think you're right. I think it reenacts and recreates amazingly probably what the experience was like. But I think it's all head and no heart. And personally, you know, I could be wrong. I expected and wanted some heart, I think. And I just didn't really get it.
No, I don't think that that's an... Yeah. Incorrect criticism.
Exactly like you say about Gravity. Because, I mean, Gravity, apart from maybe a little bit of George Clooney in there, again, you were wowed by it, technically. But I don't really care. You know, maybe his sacrifice in that.
Well, they tried to have the story. And I don't want to start with it because we have a Gravity podcast. But they did try and have more of a story there of, like, I've lost my daughter and, you know, all that stuff that... And this didn't even really have that till the very end, where you see, oh, this guy has a family to go home to. Where we tend to think of the Doughboys.
Well, that was good. That was all great that last 5 minutes. Suddenly it started kind of like working for me, where it was like, do you mind if I write to your mother? And it's like, no, that'd be great. And like, and then him like actually going, you know, he was very brave. He was, you know, he always made me laugh and whatever. And it was like, oh, you know, and I could feel myself getting emotional then. But I'm like, it's the last 2 minutes of the film. Where's this been for the previous 2 hours? So
I think the idea was like, we're just going to pump people's adrenaline for 2 hours straight until we get to that point.
I didn't feel that pumped. I was like, beautiful, I don't want to say beautiful scenery, beautiful, you know, watching everything, you know, but yeah, I just very, I mean, like I say, chocolate box for me.
I also, someday someone needs to write a thesis or dissertation or a long book on the role of women in war movies, especially World War One and World War Two, because it's always treated as this like respite when there's a woman anywhere on screen. I mean, in particular, I'm thinking of like when I saw Fury a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Like, that, you know, you get out of the war for like a few seconds, and that's true in the books too, right? And if you, whenever they're away from the front and there's actually a woman around, and kind of this woman who's never met him before, who they barely speak each other's languages, it immediately becomes this like nurturing. Like,
so that wasn't this her angel baby, though. No, she just found that baby, didn't she?
But it always becomes this kind of either. There's always this like angel of mercy sort of aspect, which I get as like,
well, it's like, this is what we're fighting for, to get back to this or to preserve this, really, which I think there's a lot of truth in that. But there's also, and I'm not saying, you know, because the world we live in now and diversity and whatever, you need to cram in some women into a story like this.
Right.
But at the same time, yeah, it's the same stereotypes, but it's the same male stereotypes as well, really.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why I actually found Benedict Cumberbatch a little bit of a relief.
Cumberbatch?
Is it Cumberbatch?
Cumberbatch.
Cumberbatch. Cumberbatch. I'm probably thinking Band of Brothers. That's what I think. That's why I felt he was a bit of a relief, because I thought, really, his type is like, I'm going to do it anyway, you know. Uh-huh. And he was, you know. And the fact that he goes, oh, well, then, you know, we won't. It's like, oh, okay, that's good. Yeah. He's actually listened to the message, you know. Yeah. So that was kind of, I think that was good casting. People complained about the fact that he was too distracting, but I like that, because I think they used his cruel streak and kind of turned it. Yeah.
I just like, oh, it's Benedict Cumberbatch, you know, at that moment. And oh, it's, who is that powerful, you know, oaky voice? Oh, it's Mark Strong, you know. And so it's, you know, Colin Firth wanted to be in a war movie. How interesting. But apparently,
Colin Firth looking a bit chubby.
He's getting the best rations at the front line.
Andrew Scott, cheeky man with a fag.
I don't really know him aside from Fleabag. So yeah. it was an odd year for him to show up, because Fleabag's so huge over here now.
Well, you got half the cast of Sherlock there, because you got Moriarty and Sherlock.
Oh, right. So, yeah. But, I hadn't even put that together.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Should have got our older thingy Hobbit in there as well. Martin Freeman.
Yeah. I'm here too. That's all you need to know. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, I don't think in any way it's a bad movie.
No.
It's one of those movies that I think feels a hell of a lot like Oscar bait, so I'm not shocked this is when it got dropped.
Yeah.
I thought technically it was really interesting. But these days, honestly, like anything else that starts getting Oscar nominations, you start tearing apart the minute you sit down. It's the reason I can't ever enjoy Shape of Water, you know.
Yeah.
It's, what are they doing? Well, how does this check, like, off all those boxes for the Oscar voters?
Well, it's almost like as soon as it gets Oscar nominated, it's almost like a bit of a taint on it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's almost like, well, yeah, previously we just liked it, mm-hmm, for entertainment, but now we're going to really tear it apart and like analyze every part of it.
Well, how is it possibly the best movie of the year? I want to know, you know. And then that's where I start with not.
Well, like you said earlier, we were talking about the Oscars a little bit, and you were saying like, we're over 50 white guys mainly, mm-hmm, are kind of picking these films. So yeah, they're going to pick 1917 because it's full of like over 50 white guys. You know.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think my expectations were too high. I still enjoyed it. I still thought it was a good film. I would like to see it again to see if I've changed my opinion. You know, I'd really like to watch Gallipoli now, because I've seen Saving Private Ryan in the last couple of years. But I haven't seen Gallipoli for a lot of years, and I'd really like to watch that now as a companion piece.
I'd like to finally get off my butt and watch Paths of Glory, which I've never seen.
Is that the Kirk Douglas one? Yeah. The Kubrick one?
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, the only World War One movie I think I watched last year was, aside from the documentary, was The Dawn Patrol, which was Errol Flynn as a pilot, you know. But had the very similar, and you're talking about between the two world wars, they made this movie, and it was very anti-war, very much of like, we're doing this relentless thing of putting up 17-year-olds in the cockpits of planes, and only one out of eight of them is going to come back.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of the lesson of World War One that I think they keep trying to make this movie over and over and over again.
Yeah.
World War Two had kind of a different, the best years of our lives, I think, probably encapsulates how Americans tend to think of it.
Yeah.
World War One had a lot more of, we just put ourselves as Western civilization through a meat grinder, and for what? Like, we have no idea what we got out of that.
Yeah.
And it did end historically, and this is not what the movie was about. I don't think 1917 should have concerned itself with it, but it also ended kind of the era of like monarchies.
Yeah, totally.
and completely changed the map of the face of the Earth, which I don't think Americans understand.
Well, this is tricky as well, because there's no real clear villains. I mean, in World War II, you got the Nazis and Hitler. There you go.
I think with the Germans or Prussians or Bavarians or whatever they were calling themselves that week were up to in World War I was... It was a little hand-wringy, mustache twirly. I mean, it was definitely, we're gonna march across, you know, Europe and start claiming territory. We've decided we're the new Roman Empire sort of thing.
Yeah.
There was a reason we were, you know, or at least the British and French were, you know, having to draw a line. And the British, fortunately, this is all Blitzkrieg, so they, you know, need to worry about very slow flying planes eventually making their way to London. But there was a reason the British knew that they had to stop in France.
I did like that. I thought the trenches were amazing, though. I loved how the difference between the British and the German trenches, mm-hmm. just in the design, and when they went into the German bunkers and they were kind of booby trapped. All that was great.
And I think it's important to remember that's not just like movie magic. Like, all that stuff is absolutely really happening. You can still tour, as I understand it, trenches if you go to the right parts of France. They've preserved some of them for museum pieces, so people kind of get an idea of what life was like and what was actually happening. But and, you know, you can always see those aerial maps of what happened to the no man's land. And you know, it was totally cratered out like the moon, and all that stuff's back to being farmland now. But the terrain is completely different because of, you know, 4 years of fighting or 5 years of fighting.
So. Oh, yeah. I mean, just the body parts sticking out was very evocative. Yeah. And, you know, other kind of ruined guns and the fact that the Germans have destroyed their own machinery.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we tend to think of, in the U.S., I think the Civil War along those terms, but we didn't quite have the same mechanized war until the very end of the Civil War.
Yeah.
And things were so different by that point in strategy. But by the time you start talking about World War One, it's just think of tanks driving over people. I mean, that's all you need to know about it.
Totally.
It was
gas.
Yeah, gas. They didn't even get into gas in this movie.
And I'm surprised. I was kind of waiting for that. They didn't do it. Yeah, but they had barbed wire. People hanging on the barbed wire.
Yeah,
which reminded me of Gods and Monsters, actually, where he's talking James Wells, talking about his lover. Kind of, he was stuck there. Yeah.
Anyway, I did like it. I know I like have Facebook conversations with people and other things about the movie, kind of all up and down the range. I don't think you need to, have a hard line in the sand of being like a defender or supporter and get like mad at each other about this movie. It's a movie, but I'm glad I saw it. I would like to see it again too at some point. Just to see if I can step away from seeing all the seams and actually watch it as a movie.
Yeah. I would also like to show you Biggles Adventures in Time, which is our crap British version of Back to the Future, which was also made about the same time, where an American executive in 80s London keeps getting zapped back to World War One and meeting Biggles, who's basically our World War One version of James Bond, who flew a biplane and punched the Hun in the face. So I think I need to show you that at some point.
That sounds remarkable. All right, everybody. 1917 is currently out in theaters. Go see it while you can. I'm sure if it wins awards, it'll get re-released. It's been kind of doing the... I think it won some stuff at the Producers Guild. And so hopefully it'll get a bit more of a wider release or re-release if it is getting pulled. I will say in the theater when I was there, it was totally chock full.
Yeah.
And that was at like 11:30 on a Saturday. So I'm hoping people are still turning up.
I think it's doing okay box office wise. I think it's up to about 80 million. So it's not doing amazing, but it's doing pretty good.
Yeah. It's not something teenagers are going to go see, or probably even 20 somethings are going to go see, unless they're film nerds. So,
But
adults might want to see this one.
Adults, yeah.
But do not take the children.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of a PG. It's not.
No. It is gross.
It is gross.
Okay, spoiler. Like, puts his hand through the chest of a rotting dead guy by accident.
Well, yes.
That's not something the children need to be seeing. They can hold off till high school to see that.
Well, I think teens can do it. I think teens can do it.
Yeah, 14, yeah. 15, yeah.
Because it is a PG-13, isn't it? I believe.
I have no idea.
Yeah. Because I was
actually... Check a movie rating heading into a movie in a couple decades.
Because I'm not saying I'm bloodthirsty, but I was surprised by the lack of gore or damage, to be honest.
I don't know what movie you watched. Because I came away with a very different takeaway from
that movie. I like to watch The World Bunch every day. Now,
you wanted people going... And falling over with that bright red blood?
No, seriously, I was thinking... I was expecting, kind of Saving Private Ryan, you get to see everything.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, your mate's head's coming off next to you. And I found it, you know, quite... I'm trying to think of the word. Subtle, I guess, compared to that. You didn't really see that much.
No, they're also not on the front line till the very, very end.
That's true. So. That's true. I mean, but yeah, I mean, it wasn't that gory. I mean, the goriest thing for me was the corpses, I think.
Yes, and that's what I'm thinking of is you get to see all the amazing things that happen to the human body if you leave them out in the sun after they've been riddled with bullets. So, and horses and. So, yeah. 1917. It's good for the whole family. All right, I think that's it. We'll end there on dead horse corpses rotting in the sun.
Bye.
Bye.
You thought it was gory?
That about wraps it up for this edition of The Signal Watch, a production of The League of Melbotus. Thanks for sticking with us. If you enjoyed this podcast, we invite you to drop on by the Signal Watch blog, where you'll find write-ups of a wide variety of movies and more. You can drop comments on this podcast and let us know what you think. We do have a Signal Watch Patreon, and if you're so moved, we'd most certainly appreciate your support. We'll be back soon with more exceedingly high-quality content. So, until next time. God damn it, babies. You've got to be kind.